Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Waiter by Matias Faldbakken, read by Jacques Roy. Part 1. A scared dog never gets fat. Norwegian proverb. The Pig. The Hills, the restaurant, dates from a time when pigs were pigs and swine were swine, the maitre d' likes to say. In other words, from the mid-1800s. I stand here, straight-backed, in my waiter's uniform, and could just as easily have stood like this 100 years ago or more. Extreme actions are carried out by grown people every day, but not by me. I wait. I please. I move around the room, taking orders, pouring, and clearing away. At the Hills, people can gorge themselves in surroundings which are rich in tradition. They should feel welcome, but not so comfortable that they forget where they are. With a few notable exceptions, some of the diners use the place like their own parlor. The Pig, one of our regulars, apropos of pigs, sits at table 10 by the window at 2:30 every weekday. He tends to be punctual, but it's now 1:41 and he hasn't made an appearance. I do a loop of the entrance, no Pig. The cloakroom attendant, Pedersen, looks up from his paper. Pedersen is distinguished, as they say. He's seemingly seen it all. The guests trade their possessions, jackets, coats, bags, umbrellas, for a tag which they later, accompanied by a coin or two, swap for the same possessions when they leave. He has carried out these transactions with measured feeling and pride all these years. He does his job well. We're all diligent here at the Hills. It's a diligent place. Diligence and concern go hand in hand, I'm convinced of that. Lunch is underway, and the main room has filled up with the upper middle class, silky skinned, softly spoken, elegant clothes. There is a row of smaller cafe tables with classic marble tops by the entrance. In that area, the acoustics are sharper. Deeper into the room, tablecloths have been draped over the tables. There is clinking, but the noise is muted. Cutlery is moved around porcelain and up to mouths. Teeth chew, throats rise and fall, they swallow. It's all about eating in here, and I'm a facilitator. I never take part in the eating myself. I observe the intake. There's a considerable distance between the experience of ingesting a strong picodon de chèvre, the gastronomic explosion in your mouth, and watching the lips of someone else doing it. I set the tables as densely as possible, continental style. There's not quite room, but I find space and squeeze in extra glasses, side plates, another bottle. It feels rich. The chandelier isn't especially big, no bigger than a horse's nose bag, but it is heavy and hangs like a crystal sack from the low vaulted ceiling above the round table in the middle of the room. There are concentric circles of well-trampled mosaic tiles on the floor. All the woodwork is solid, dark, and worn. The two large mirrors are impressive. The reflective coating on the back of the glass has cracked here and there. It adds a nice patina. The Art Nouveau-esque oak frames around the mirrors were mounted in 1901. That's what the bar manager told me, elaborating with details about how the wood was dragged down from Ekeberg by Fritz Tholov's very own horse. The bar manager is the restaurant's memory. Her face is like an academic's, but she's a bit too cheerful to be an academic. She sees everything. The Hills might resemble a Viennese coffee house, but this isn't Vienna. It may look like a grand European, but it's too worn, too grimy to match the grandeur you would find on the continent. The establishment, the premises, has been called the Hills for almost 150 years now. The name comes from the Hill family, who ran an outfitter's shop there from 1846. The bar manager knows all about that. Benjamin Hill, the head of the family, a legendary but tragic dandy, originally from Windsor in England, gambled away 2/3 of the family fortune and stumbled into a painful bankruptcy which ended in attempted suicide and subsequent disability. The entrepreneur who took over the space opened a restaurant called La Grenade, but the original stained glass sign covering parts of the facade was so lavish and elaborate, not to mention well-mounted, that he left it there, and the place became, as one can imagine, known popularly as the Hills. Benjamin Hill's energetic son eventually bought back the premises, took over the business, and resurrected the family name. The Hills remains under family control to this day. From a curved brass pipe installed above the entrance, there are two thick curtains which stop the heat from leaking out, each with calfskin sewed onto the edge to prevent wear and tear. In through this covering, the Hills' portal, or stage curtain, if you like, enters the pig at last, smiling and nodding. It's almost 10 to 2, on the verge of the tolerable, that is. I neither nod nor smile back. I'm fundamentally neither a smiler nor a nodder. I don't have to make much of an effort to fulfill that particular waiter's instruction, a blank but obliging face to the guests. A poker face is all part of the craft. "Apologies for the lateness," the pig says, laughing apologetically, not with a grunt, but with some kind of neigh. What do you call the neigh an ass makes? A bray? The pig chuckles with a sharp bray, the way he often does. I've sometimes thought that the pig is an ass, in the figurative sense, like an ass from European mythology and literature, not the ancient Greek stubborn and stupid ass, but the biblical, reliable and loyal kind. Not that he's all that reliable right now. "How many today?"
4, myself included," says the pig.
"And the others are on their way?"
"I expect so."
There are many ways to dress. The pig has chosen the only acceptable one. Impeccably. He constantly has new suits, and judging by the cut, the seams, and the quality of the material, they must be from the tailors on Savile Row or thereabouts. With an age of just over 60 years, and dressed in such a wardrobe on a daily basis, he is in every sense an elegant man and model guest. The pig fits the Hills like a glove. That's why we give him wiggle room with the number of guests, late arrivals, nonsense about the table, and so on. Not that it happens often. The pig is wealthy, that much is clear, but he is also some kind of introvert. Steadily, quietly, he brings new contacts and acquaintances to the Hills, primarily for lunch, occasionally for dinner, always polite, and always with this impeccability in attire and manners. "We've held the usual window table," I say, holding out my hand as I grab 4 menus and lead him through the room. With perfect timing, I pull out his chair and repeat the set phrase, "Some mineral water while you wait?"
"Yes, please."
He turns around and allows me to gently push the chair into the hollows of his knees. The pig has a thick, grayish-white mane which he keeps short with a weekly trim. He turned gray during his 20s, while he was making a career in Paris, and was given the nickname de Gris, which immediately became Grisen, the pig, on his return to Norway. His eyebrows are still dark, giving him an intelligent look like a Castelli, or dog-like like a Scorsese. Blay. Old Johansson, the house pianist, is sitting at the grand piano on the mezzanine, looking at the vaulted ceiling and, to the left, into thin air. His stubby, pope-like fingers dance over the keys with light steps and considerable experience, producing seamless, barely audible music. Is this Tafel music? He chooses the great composers, Johansson, but it's still Tafel. Occasionally, his eyes close as the notes trill in all directions down into the restaurant. Old, stuffed Johansson. His head drops toward his shoulders, and it looks like he's nodded off for a moment, but then it rolls back into position and his eyes snap open. He carries on like that for hours. For a generation and a half now, he's been there for endless stretches at a time, his head bobbing away every day on the mezzanine, that mid-ceiling, playing pleasant tones in succession for the guests. Since we arrive at different times, we rarely speak, but people say he has a sharp sense of humor. The napkins are stacked with neat folds on a low shelf between 2 pillars in the middle of the room. A glass screen with pale Art Nouveau lines stands on top of the shelf, acting as a buffer between tables 12 and 8. If I find myself empty-handed, I often go over to the napkin shelf, where I hide behind the screen and straighten the napkins with an extra crease. The newbie, Vanessa, is a bit careless here. I make sure that the Hills' logo is in the top right-hand corner.
"Do you have the white burgundy today?" says the pig.
"Of course." I wait 2 tasteful beats before I ask.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.